wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know.
Breath that I Well, good morning. We want to welcome each and every one of you this morning, and I hope you have come prepared for God to move in your life in a powerful way. Amen. Those watching on the live stream, we want to say a welcome to you and let you know that we have prayed for you. We pray that God will speak to you and that the Spirit will move in your life today. We also want to let you know that though you may be at home, you are a very special part of this church family, because we know that the church does not reside in these walls, but resides inside each and every believer. So it's such a blessing that we can worship across the world today. I lastly want to say a special welcome to those watching who do not have a church home, and especially those who are still considering their faith and have not yet accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. We want to welcome you and want you to know that you are loved and that this church family can help you through that faith journey. So welcome. We love you. As a reminder, there will not be parking lot praise going forward due to the cooler weather and due to the darker evenings, but we want to say a special thank you to all those who helped make that praise service a special time. It was such a blessed time together, but we just want to inform you that going forward, the parking lot praise will not happen going forward. Well, have you come to give God glory today? Let me ask that again. Have you come to give God glory today? Psalm 29:9 says, "And in his temple everything says glory," which is the verbal outpouring expression of proclaiming his glory. And in Psalm 48:9 it says, "Within your temple, O God, we meditate on your unfailing love," which is the inner meditation that focuses on God's unfailing love. This morning, right now, we are the church. We are that temple of God. No matter where we are, let us all meditate and focus our hearts and our minds on his unfailing love. And at the same time, let us open our mouths and give him the full praise that he deserves. So are you ready to worship this morning? If so, say amen. Amen. We're going to open in prayer. And as I do, let us focus on God's glory and his unfailing love. Let's pray. Father God, it's humbling to know that your presence is here with us right now. Lord, that you, the manifestation of you, Lord, lives within us, Lord, and we thank you. Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit is in us and through us and around us. And Lord, we pray that you will speak to us and transform us during these times of worship. Lord, we've not come to this place for us. We've come to this place to give you worship, Lord, to thank you for all the blessings that you've given to us. But Lord, at the same time, Lord, help us be blessed. Help us become more like Christ, even in this very hour. Lord, we pray right now that you'll speak to us, that your word will come alive to us, Lord, that you'll sense our love and our purpose and our praise to you, Lord, because you deserve all the honor and glory. Father God, we pray that you'll be blessed. Lord, speak to us now. Guide us, convict us, we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you. We are going to sing to the Lord this morning. Stand up and bless the Lord, for he is worthy. This song says, our God is faithful from beginning to end. His love can't be mistaken. So we will stand up and bless the Lord, for he is worthy. He is the great and mighty one. He is worthy to be praised. Let's stand up and bless the Lord. Our God is faithful from beginning to end. His love can't be mistaken. He is our fortress and our hope he defends. He cannot be shaken. He has done, for he has done great things for us. He has done great things. So let us come before his throne with praise. Stand up and bless the Lord. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is the great and mighty one. He is worthy. He is worthy to be praised. Our God is faithful from beginning to end. His love can't be mistaken. He is our fortress and our hope he defends. He cannot be shaken, for he has done, for he has done great things for us. Has done great things, so let us come before his throne with praise. Stand up and bless the Lord. He's worthy, he's worthy. He is the great and mighty one. He is worthy to be praised. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. So 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 praise the Lord, hallelujah. Let's praise the Lord, hallelujah. So praise the Lord, hallelujah. Let's praise the Lord. Has done great things for us. He has done great things. Come on, he has done. He has done great things for us. Yeah, he has done great things. For he has done great things for us. Yeah, he has done great things. Amen. So let us come before his throne with praise. Stand up and bless the Lord. He are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, I worship you.
Sing, you are here.
You are here, you're moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, God, I worship you. Yes, you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Touching every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're healing every heart, I worship you, I worship you. Turning lives, you are here, you're turning lives up. I worship you, I worship you.
You're mending every heart,
you're mending every heart. I worship you,
oh God, I worship you.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Light in the dark.
us, who is our delight in our darkness, who's our promise keeper. You are so faithful to us, God, and we worship you this morning for what you have done for us, but also because you are holy, you are worthy, and you deserve it. We love you this morning, Lord. Stay with us. We ask for your presence here to stay with us. In your name, amen. Have a seat.
Wow. The Lord is holy and his presence is here with us. Praise God for that. Well, we have the opportunity to continue our worship by the giving of our tithes and offering. And with our financial giving, we show gratitude by giving back to God a portion of what he has so graciously given to us. So as we take our offering, let us give generously and cheerfully. And those here in the building, we will ask that you give your offering on the offering plates on your way out of this service. And those online, you have multiple options to give. On our SalvationArmyGwinnett.org website, you will find a link there to our Tithely website where you can give online. You will also find a QR code on your screen. Just hover over that QR code with your smartphone, and it will take you to the Tithely website to give online. Well, as we worship through our giving, the band is going to play a song you may have already heard, but Power in the Blood, where the words say, "Would you be free from the burden of sin?" There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory when there's wonderful power in the blood? So as we give, let's give with grateful hearts. Let's pray. Father God, we're so grateful for who you are and what you've done and for your presence here with us even now. Father God, you've given us so much, Lord, and we're so blessed and we're so grateful, Lord. And right now, through our worship, we give back to you what is rightly yours. Father God, we pray that you will use these gifts to build your kingdom. And Father God, be blessed by the giving. With our purposeful hearts, we pray in your holy name. Amen.
You can hear me. Okay, well, now I'm going to need some help. And I was thinking maybe we had a couple of kids who would be willing to come up and help. Let's see, who would that be? Be the first, don't be the last. Olivia, come on down. Ben. If y'all want to come, you can come. I won't force anybody, only if you're comfortable. Josh, you want to come on up? What? Yes, from the pastor's child, yes. All right, so what we have here is a board, and there's some things that we need to look at with this board. First of all, we need to put it in the right direction. So this is the way that it's going to go. And what I need for everybody is to find a place where there is a stick poking out, and that is your stick. So go ahead and find a place. Probably the taller ones can be over here. Josh, do you want to come sit over here? We're only going to be here for a couple minutes, but we want to make sure we wear our masks. We want to be safe. Awesome, wonderful. Yep, you can come through. There we go. Now, today, and actually this whole month, we have been talking about something specific. Can anybody tell me what it is we've been talking about? Those of you out there, wherever you are, I want you to answer as well. What have we been talking about in church the last couple weeks? Can you remember? Yeah?
No idea.
No idea, yes. That's right. Anybody want to take a guess? It's okay. It's okay. Obviously, all answers are welcome in some form or fashion. We have been talking about the lost son. And today, what we're going to have is a presentation where we can see the decisions that the lost son made. Now, I have two here, two balls, and one represents the lost son and one represents the older brother. So if this is the older brother, we obviously know that this is the what brother?
Little brother.
Yeah, little brother, right? The younger brother. That's exactly right. Now, I am going to be placing one right here, one of these brothers, and we're going to make the decision of which one is going to go first. And once I put it down, the trick is we don't want to go fast. So I need everybody's help in making sure that it doesn't tip over, because Captain Annalise and hot glue are not a good mix. So we want to make sure that things don't tear and rip and fall apart right here in front of everybody.
Mom?
Yes. Yes. What?
How do you play this game?
Okay, we're getting to that. Thank you so much for asking. So a brother is going to be placed right here. This is the starting point. And then we're going to see which way he's going to go. Now, the most important thing is that the journey is not fast. It's not a fast journey. We're not trying to rip and tumble and everything like that. We want to make sure that we make the good and right decisions in the way that the story is played out. So the most important thing is that we understand the journey, not that the journey goes really fast. So once I place him here, we are going to figure out which way he's going to go. So first we need to decide who is going to be first, the younger brother or the older brother? The younger brother. That's perfect, because he goes first in the story anyway. So when I place him here, we're going to see that there are two sides. Let's hold him steady. Hold him steady as best as you can. He has a decision to make. And when he gets to this point here, as you can see up there, there are two places that he can go. Is anybody able to read what this side says?
Disobedience.
Disobedience. And this side says? Obedience. So there is a decision to be made, and every single one of us have this decision to be obedient or to be disobedient. Now, we know that the younger brother does what?
Disobedient.
He's disobedient, and that is going to take him the way of the world. Boom, boom, boom. Okay?
Well, how do we do it?
Well, you're going to hold on to your sticks there, leave him there, and you're going to roll it. So everybody has to work together. Awesome, you guys, very good. And we want to make sure, now, oh my goodness, and you know, that's how life is sometimes. Sometimes we just skip over parts, but oh, we got to work together. That is okay. All right, hold it straight, don't move. We're going to take the brother back for just a moment, okay? He's going too fast, and he's breaking everything. Not you guys, the younger brother, okay? So we're going to take our time with this, okay? He was disobedient. And that's what happens. All the sticks break when we're disobedient. Very good. Very good. Now, when we go the way of disobedience for this son, this meant that he asked his father for all the money that was going to be going to him. Now, usually the money that goes to you from your parents is when something happens in life. When for this son, it would have been when his father had passed on. Those things would have come to him. But he said, no, I am ready now. I want to go live my life the way I want it to be. And that is where we are. So we are going down the disobedient way. And you know what? You could probably just hold on to the board here. It was good thinking, but, you know, sometimes even Miss Captain just doesn't know what the right way to go is. Ooh. So we're going to move him this way. We're going to try our best to get him to go down the money way. He's got his money. Now he's coming down. Now what does this say here?
Party.
Very good. And that's exactly what it is he is going to do. Oh yeah, he's partying and it's happening. So we're going to make him go through the party hat. He's going to come through. Hey, very good. Now we're going to stop right here. Yes, all of his money is gone. He has spent it on going to Disney World. He's gone to, I don't know, Frankie's Fun Park, Six Flags, Cedar Point, any of those places there. He has gone everywhere and lived it up all over the place. Now, yes.
But those didn't exist.
Are you sure about that? Were you there? I don't think so. Don't be the younger brother here. Don't lie. All right, so we're going to place him back over here, and we're going to find that he ends up going to a very not good place, mentally, physically, and emotionally. And when he gets to, just leave the sticks, they're good, it's okay.
The sticks are broken.
They are broken, that's right. So when he comes through here, there are some words that are written, and what does it say?
Empty,
lonely, cold, miserable, and there's all these snowflakes. And he ends up in a place, let's hold him right there. Where does he end up?
In the mud.
With the pigs, that's exactly right, in the mud. And he isn't even able to get a Happy Meal, right? Right? A Happy Meal, yeah, because you were there. So he is going to go through the pigs. Yeah. And what he decides, if you can hold the younger brother right there, what he decides at that point is he is at the lowest point he could possibly be. The lowest point. And he makes a decision. And this decision is what? What does he decide to do?
Go back home.
He decides to go back home. Now, do you think it was as easy for him just to say, that'll take me back. I'm going back home. It wasn't that easy, was it? There were some things he had to go through, and I want to read what these words say. Can you? This one's kind of a big one.
Worthless.
A Big Mac word. Worthless. What does this one say? Dirty.
Unforgiven.
Trash. That's exactly right. Those are some of the things that were rattling around in his head. And sometimes when we get to positions like this, when we've done everything that we can to push the people that we love away, sometimes those things go through our head that we're worthless, that people don't care about us, but that couldn't be further from the truth. But sometimes those are the things that we think about. That's okay, just swipe that right under the altar there. All right, let's go ahead and work through those things, yeah? Dirty, unforgiven, trash. Very good. Now, we have a couple of options here. We can get stuck in these same things that we've been thinking about, how maybe gross we are, inferior, meaning we don't feel like we're up to where everybody else is, fruitless, dead, bad. Maybe we can get stuck in these things, and if we get stuck there, sometimes it's kind of hard to get out of that way, but we don't want to get stuck there, do we? There's somewhere that we want to go, and what does this say? It is the straight and narrow way. That's exactly right. It's very narrow, so it'd be easy to get into this other position over here and just keep bumping around the walls and not really doing anything. But we need to find that straight and narrow way. And when we find this way, what happens? That's exactly right. We end up with the Father. And there are so many good words that are here. Can anybody just read out a few things that we have when we are with the Father, when we make our way back to Him? Where are we?
Forgiveness, strength,
blessed, blessing,
yeah.
Alive.
Y'all are really good readers, and I'm glad I spelled them correctly. So this is where our younger brother ends up, and that is a good place to be, and that's the place we need to be. But also, we also understand that there are two decisions we can make. It's we don't end up having to go that way if we end up with the Lord. We can just make it straight away this way. This is where who else comes in?
The older brother, right?
Well, let's see here. The older brother, did he ask for money?
No.
His money? What ended up happening?
He waited until...
Which way is he going to go?
No.
They're all broken. You're finally a man, son. Good job. We want him. Good. So he stayed with the father, right? There are two decisions that we have to make, and we have two decisions that we can make in life. Let it be. Just let it be. It's okay. Now, for us, for the older brother, what do you think some things might he have thought if the younger brother, now this looks like a whole lot of fun, really. I mean, I want to go through pom-poms, little pom-poms around all the time. That would be an amazing life to live. But if the older brother saw that the younger brother was able to get and do all these things, he got all the money he wanted, and then he found his way back, what are some things you might be thinking of if you saw your younger brother? Yeah, for sure. And he's the little brother, right? I am the big brother. I should be able to do the things that I want to do. I stayed with Father. Why is it that he is able to get a nice robe? Why is it he's able to get the family ring? Why is it that he gets to have a huge feast? So these are a lot of good questions and things sometimes we can be thinking about. But you know what the most important thing is for our younger brother and our older brother? What's the most important thing? They're both with the Father, right? And that is a celebration. That is what is most important in life, in our families, in our friends, in everyone in the world. We want them to be a part of the Father. Now, for us, moving forward, I have something for you, and you might think it's silly, and that's okay, because Miss Captain can be really silly. I have something for you, and I want you to choose one. I have found them from the finest Walmart in the land and have sanitized them with the finest sanitation in the area. But I want you to choose one of these rings, and you can choose any color that you want. You don't have to wear it unless you want to. Nope, they're all with one letter. Mm-hmm. Josh is very excited. Calm it down, buddy. Your ring has a letter on it. What is the letter?
G.
This is a family ring. When we look at it, we think about the family that we are in. And whose family do we belong to?
God.
Yes, you are so right. Now, like I said, you don't have to wear it. It might be a little girly, so I'm going to wear it. And you are all boys. Where's Olivia? Oh, that's okay. That's okay. Oh, Ben, you take one to her, too. This one's a pretty one. She'd like that. But you are in the family of God. This ring represents whom you belong to. And when we get to the point of making the decisions in our life, we want to belong to which way? We want to belong with the Father. And God is our Father. That's exactly right. So please know that you are loved by everyone here. You are loved by God. You at home are loved by everyone here. And you are loved by God. And I pray for each and every one of you. And when decisions come into our life, we want to go this direction. But if ever a time comes where we go the opposite direction, hey, girl, come on down. Got a stick right here for you. That we would choose to be with the Father, and we can always come home to Him. All right, as she comes, this is it. Thank you all very much. You can take your rings with you. You can choose between these two. Which one do you like the best? Yes, I agree, that one. All right, y'all can head back to your seats. Thank you so much for your help.
Thank you. Thank you.
Six boys and a ball, what could go wrong? Good morning, so good to see all of you. And we're going to sing a congregational song now, a very familiar one. This was actually written by a fellow by the name of James Montgomery back in the 1800s. And he actually wrote it as a children's song. The words to the first verse were, "Stand up and bless the Lord, ye children of his choice." But it was so popular that the adults stole it, and it became "Ye people of his choice." But I'm going to ask you to stand. We're going to sing four verses of Stand Up and Bless the Lord. We have a special arrangement. We'll be led by Nick Simmons and his band of renown. It's four measures intro. We'll sing two verses, a little ditty in the middle, and then we'll sing the final two verses. Here we go. Stand up and bless the Lord, ye people of his joy, stand up and bless the Lord your God with heart and soul and voice.
Good morning, everybody. The scripture this morning is being taken from Luke chapter 15, verses 25 through 32. Again, that's Luke chapter 15, verses 25 to 32. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when the son of yours, who has squandered your property in prostitutes, comes home, you killed the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we have to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found."
Cooking show that caught my attention. It did. See, I usually, and by what I mean by usually is never, watch reality TV. However, this show was about barbecue pit masters. Yeah, it was a competition. You know what I'm talking about. Amen. Amen. See, this is, you're speaking my language. This is my language. This is my home tongue. Is barbecue. See, the handful of local pit masters from various locations across the United States are competing to be deemed the pit master of America. Now, as a Texas boy who appreciates good barbecue, especially good brisket, so if you know a place, I do take recommendations here in the area. This show naturally, of course, grabbed my attention. Now, the concept is easy. The judges pick the style that they're looking for. There was even, believe it or not, was even a Caribbean barbecue pit master. Yeah. Who was really putting on the jerk, all the stuff. I mean, it was really impressive to watch. But they would go and pick their meat, pick the seasoning that goes with it, the cooking process and the right temperatures and all this sort of thing. And, of course, the sides, because in this competition, you're not just judged on the meat, but the sides hold equal a judging authority. Like they're the same. Like so, you have to have both. Now, once time is up, the judge judges you on the usual stuff, taste and presentation. So that's what you have to get ready and be prepared for. But regardless of the show, regardless if it's American Idol or if it's a barbecue cooking show, the judges are what brings in the ratings. No matter what, it's not always the competition or itself, it's always the judges. See, the judge's job is to try to bring the audience into the room, like if you're there with them. They want you to taste what they're tasting. They want you to smell what they're smelling. And I bet you a barbecue cooking show is a really good smelling on the set there. But they want you to experience the excitement or the shame that the contestants feel once judgment has been cast. And when the contestants are doing what the Hollywood business refers to as their talking heads, that's the bit where they're like talking to the camera and they're giving you the behind the scenes one-on-one kind of thing, what they're usually giving you, the audience, is a list of things that are going wrong at the moment. Right? Here, the temperature's not getting up to the bit. I have to set the right type of wood. If I was back at home, I would use this. I usually, my wife is with me to do the sides. It's always a list
of all the things that could be going wrong, that they are wanting the audience to feel sorry for them and to hopefully, through all this process, that the judges will also feel sorry for them and be a little lenient. At the same time, though, when they, of course, the camera guy brings up their competitors, they talk, very negatively, and they hope that the judges come down with the swift, mighty arm of judgment on them and their lack of preparation. And what we are seeing in these cases, of no matter what show it is that it is a case of wanting grace for ourselves, but demanding justice for those around us, which is exactly where we are picking up in our story today in the prodigal son. So let's have a word of prayer this morning. God, we just thank you for the opportunity to be here and to open your word and to just explore and to dive in and to truly break bread. Father, we just pray that as we continue to look into the prodigal son, that your truth, your words be spoken, Lord. God, I pray now that anything that comes out of my mouth is in total and complete alignment with the gospel truth. And so, Father, this is our prayer. Open our hearts and minds now to listen to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So the entire story up to this point has all been about the young son and the father. That's what we pretty much have been talking about for the last 3 weeks now. The young son had shamed the father. He spent all of his money at Disney World and Six Flags and these other things that we just learned about. And then he hits rock bottom with the pigs. Everyone got excited about that. But thankfully, he came to his senses and he travels home to be, to be surprised by a welcoming and forgiving father. And the young son's story ends with a party. Because he was once lost, and then now he's found. A perfect way to end the story, if it ended there. Jesus, however, wasn't finished with this story. He intentionally brings up the older brother. He didn't have to, but he did. He could have just ended the story there. We never would have known there was an older brother in the field. Never would have come to our, paid attention to it. But Jesus wanted to mention him, bring him up, that after the young son had returned, Jesus continued the story by saying this. Meanwhile. So now we're taking a little detour. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. And so he called one of the servants and he asked him, what was going on? Your brother has come, he replied. And your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. Now, I can imagine the older son in this moment when he was seeing and experienced this, leaving the field and then seeing the commotion in the house, watching his father embrace his younger son within his arms, perhaps even a kiss on his forehead at the celebration. And it was probably right then at that moment when he saw this in the distance that an emotion began to stir within his own soul, that he began to question what he was actually seeing, that from the eyes of the older brother, his own eyes, the prodigal son has indeed returned, but has returned with no judgment. His perception and reaction of his return was nothing like the father's. In fact, the reaction of the older brother is the reaction that the younger son expected to see from his father. So verse 28 says, the older brother became angry, and he refused to go in. So his father went out, and he pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, You killed the fattened calf for him. Now, let me lay out in context what that transaction, what just took place in that story. In the Jewish culture, right, in this transaction, when dad says, come inside the house, you come inside the house. That's how that works. You, even if you are displeased with your father's commands, you still honor your father and you do what he says. If you're unhappy with him, with whatever he is commanding or giving to you, then you share your concerns privately at a time that is appropriate among the two of you. But the older brother here in this moment refuses to enter his house that his father had asked him, and he will not enter. And so now, at this point in the story, Jesus is telling a different story for a different crowd. He is now telling a story about a father who has not only been shamed by one son, but who has now been shamed by two. Why? Why bring the older brother into the story at all? I mean, this was a pretty happy story. Why bring him in? The assumption was that the younger son was the problem child and the older son was the good son that stayed home with dad, did what he's supposed to do, worked in the fields, and would never disobey his father. But Jesus was telling a story that was not only intended for the tax collectors listening in, the younger son, but also a message for the Pharisees and the crowd, the older son. And so Jesus continues this story with the father's response after the older son disobeys. My son, says the father, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now he is found. And just like that, after that statement, the story's over. That's it. And man, what a way to end. We never get to see what the older brother does or how he reacts after the father speaks to him. The story just ends. And I can imagine right then as Jesus was wrapping that up and just putting the little period and cleaning up that story, Pharisees were walking away offended by what they just heard, and tax collectors were on their knees weeping, begging to come home. And the father's response to the older son simply is saying that God's love and grace is equal to all. Regardless if we are a new believer or a long time believer, Jesus was telling the Pharisees that you don't get to choose who receives God's grace, that God doesn't withhold grace from the same people that we withhold grace from. Jesus' death on the cross means that there is a celebration waiting for anyone who is ready to come home. Anyone who is ready to come home, that the Father is going to celebrate the arrival. And I think the reason why that we don't see the end or the response of the Son after the Father really speaks into him and tells him that everything, and we don't get to hear the rebuttal, the comment back from the Son, is because we are now seeing how that story lives in real life. We are the response to that story. We are. And as I was preparing to conclude this sermon series, which I have thoroughly enjoyed researching and writing and everything that's taken to piece this together, I decided to take one final good look at this story in its entirety. Just to start from let's just comb through it to examine the story and make sure that I didn't miss anything. And when I went back and I saw the story play out, my eyes began to see something different. It was interesting. As I went back, I started to see the story of the church unfold, of the church of God, the church of Christ, the church. I saw it unfold. That within the story of the prodigal son, the church can be seen at every angle of the story. You see, each of us are in our Father's country. We're in his home. We're with him. We don't have to worry where we're going to get our next meal, within his home, within his country, within his family. We don't worry about our clothes, or we don't worry about the needs, because we are with our Father. And some of us know our Father and choose to stay in his land. We choose to work in his fields and to serve him well, to go and get the things that he's asking us to do and to be in relationship with the people he's asked us to be in relationship with, that we know him and love him well, that we choose to stay with him, while others choose to leave. They choose to leave. And when the time comes for a prodigal son or daughter to return home, the head of the church, the Father, Jesus Christ, is eagerly waiting for their return, standing outside, so that way when they see him in the distance, come home. Come home. And in fact, when that person comes into the Father's country, he says, quick, get my son and my, get the family ring, get the clothes, get the sandals, get the fattened calf, because you are now home. And in the church, we respond either as the servants who share the great news of the return, who go and start to get and collect all the things that the Father said to do, to go and grab all of the little pieces that make the journey home and the return home a celebration, to go get the fattened calf, that we can fetch and do the things that Father has asked us to do, or we respond as the older brother, who even refused to go into the house. And I just say, forgive us, Lord, when we fall short of your kingdom. Are we the church waiting at the door, ready to run? When we see the prodigal son or daughter in the distance, are we ready to embrace them and show them the path to the foot? And it doesn't mean that this church, this location, no. It could be in our home, be online, could be anywhere. But are we the church ready to embrace and show them the path to the foot of the cross? Or are we like the older brother, eager and ready for judgment? You know, this story of the prodigal son was a great reminder for me when I came home. I remember that. And I came home and I was able to experience the true grace and forgiveness that just wasn't granted to me by some people, by loved ones. But I remember a Heavenly Father, Prince of Peace, the King of Kings, who was waiting by the door and said, come in. And Lord, that day I still celebrate. So I want to close with this. That if you right now are the lost son or daughter, go home. There is a loving Father waiting for you with his arms open. And if you're on that journey home, there's going to be a surprise waiting for you Knock out all that fear. Knock out all that. There's going to be open arms. And if we are the older brother, then I pray, and I think we should, ask the Lord's understanding on our heart. And maybe we can go fetch a thing or two for him while we're at it. Father, we just pray now, in this moment, for your story, this prodigal son, Lord, to be written onto our heart, so that way when we walk out of here and we hear this either online or wherever this story may be told, that it becomes a part of our spiritual identity, that all of us were the prodigal son coming home. And then may we never forget that image of when we had to hit the bottom and come to our senses and run back home to the Father's arm. But Lord, I guarantee you that we all in our minds now know someone who is still lost. Lord, can you please use us as a vessel, as a tool to show the love, the grace, and the mercy waiting for them at the cross? That Father, I just pray that we are the church that's waiting by the door with open arms. And that God, I now pray for the heart that if any of us, including myself, are the older brother in the fields expecting only the best, that God maybe be reminded that Jesus had to go to a cross and die, and that he was giving his best when it happened. And so Lord, maybe we live a sacrificial life, no matter how long we've been with you, no matter how long we've enjoyed your country, Lord, but maybe remember that it was only there because of a sacrifice that was given. And may we, God, please live to that standard. Call us, Lord, to serve your people. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys.
Body began to breathe.
everybody began to breathe out of the silence. The roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah, praise the Lord.
Please, let's rise for the benediction. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority, through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
If you are here worshiping with us, if you will stay where you are for just a moment, we have some people that will be coming to dismiss everybody. Thank you and God bless.